Welcome to the Overcome America Hair Loss Summit. My name is Valerie Fuentes. I'm your host, and today I am with Kim Dubs. I am so thrilled that you're here with us. I have to tell you guys a little bit of background story. I have to literally almost stalk Kim to get her in, and I'm just so happy that you're here because you're one of my favorite accounts, and I just really love how you're authentically sharing your hair loss journey. So thank you, Kim, for being here.
Right?
Yeah. So on that note, I'll tell you guys what happened. So like, as you know, as our accounts start growing, it's really hard to keep up with DMs and messages and all this stuff. And so as I was reaching out to the ladies to participate, it gets harder. Like the larger the account is, the harder it is to get a hold of you because the messages go to like a different inbox if you're not following me or things like that. Yeah. So in order to like actually get a hold of Kim, I was like reaching out to people. Do you know Kim? Do you mind?
She got you stalking me.
And then I messaged her, hey, I'm sorry, I'm not stalking you. So here we are. So thank you.
Here we are.
Here we are. So Kim, for those of you who don't know you yet, can you tell us a little bit about you and your hair loss story?
Yeah, so my hair loss probably started around about when I was 20. I've always had, or always thought that I had thin hair. And it was never really prominent or noticeable to me until probably 2018, about 3 months after I had stopped taking birth control, and I started noticing clumps of my hair coming out in the shower, and that was a very scary moment. And I remember taking a mirror to the back of my hair, and I actually took my phone and took a video of the back of my hair, and that was like, whoa, okay, I didn't realize that there was all that going on back there. And it was that moment that I started to panic, and I started researching on Google, and you know, you do the whole how do I stop my hair falling out type of thing. You go to the chemist and you buy the Rogaine, and you start taking all these vitamins and mm-hmm. these like gummies, and you book in at a hair loss clinic, and I start joining these Facebook groups and reading all the forums, and you know, just trying to find answers every single night was, you know, up till midnight, 1 a.m. trying to find some kind of hair loss solution. I bought all these books and read all these things about, you know, women's health, and, you know, started getting tests done. I was thinking, oh, maybe it's my thyroid, maybe I'm low in iron. So I started taking all these vitamins and all this crap, and probably saw like 4 different doctors. I went to a dermatologist, and by that point, I finally got the referral and got into this dermatologist was when I'd found this Instagram community. And that was when I discovered hair toppers and wigs and all that sort of stuff. And that was kind of a life-changing moment for me because I realized I didn't have to spend all this money on treatments and all this stuff. And there was a way that I could cover it up at least if I still wanted to find a way to make my hair grow back. And yeah, then I guess once I discovered hair toppers and I finally got mine, I just wanted to share with the world and other women that, you know, you don't have to be alone in this whole thing, that most women who are dealing with hair loss are covering it up. Because I would go down the street and look at people's hair, and I would go, there's no one with the same sort of hair as me. And I was just thinking, like, I'm the only one. Like, at the time, I think I was 26, and I just thought, like, I'm too young to be dealing with this. I'm not, you know, in my 40s or anything like that, or 50s, not that that's old, but, you know. And so, yeah, finding other women in like an Instagram community where they're sharing their journey, that was definitely like totally changed my life. So that's sort of my story.
Totally. No, and it is life-changing to find other women that are going through the same. And I can totally relate because I want to say like the heaviest of my hair loss was when I was in college on my 20s. And like you said, you kind of sort of obsess with other people's hairlines and you start looking at everybody. And then I don't know if this happened to you, but I was the only one with hair loss in my family. Like my sister has beautiful hair. My mom to this day has hair, like, you know, everybody in my family. So you're like, what is going on? And why me?
Yeah. Yeah. Right?
So how did you deal with it? Well, okay. First question is, are you still trying to grow your hair? Where are you at with that?
No, I have, not that I've given up on my hair, but now I just don't, like I don't color my hair anymore because I went from coloring, like having a full head of blonde foils from when I was 18. So when my hair started falling out, I thought, okay, maybe it's because I'm coloring my hair and my hair's really damaged from, you know, bleach blonding it. And so I stopped doing that and I think that was actually one of the hardest moments because I'd had this identity of being blonde Kim and my hair's quite dark. It's not brunette, but it's like a dark blonde color. And so as my hair was growing out the color, I started to, I guess, lose the identity of who I was. And that was a really, really difficult thing to sort of go through. It wasn't just my hair falling out, it was totally changing my identity and who I was. So that was probably, yeah, that was really, really hard.
Yeah, and I totally get that. I actually also used to dye my hair red when I was in high school. And I totally relate of, you know, people telling me and my family telling me, oh, it's because you dye your hair too much. Maybe if you stop coloring your hair will be better. No, yeah. Can't get any better. But yeah. Okay. So how did you deal with it emotionally? Right. Cause I know like wearing hair helps us a lot and it's life changing. Right. But was there anything about, you know, the emotional piece of hair loss that you dealt with in a specific way?
I think what happened was when, you know, my hair started falling out. It wasn't just that going on. There was the fact that I'd come off the pill and that kind of triggered a lot of other stuff that was going on with my body. I had cystic acne. I had issues with my internal system. And it also triggered me into like a really dark spiral of depression and anxiety. And the only way that I was able to get myself out of that was by going and seeing a psychologist who I still speak to and see now. I think to begin with, I kind of thought, oh yeah, like this isn't the worst thing that could ever happen to me. Like, you know, I don't need somebody to help me. But I did, like I needed counselors and psychologists and stuff because it wasn't just the hair, it was losing my identity and all this other stuff that was going on. So, you know, I kind of wanted to be this like, oh, you know, I'm strong enough to get through all of this on my own, but like in the end, like I wasn't, and I knew that I was really, really struggling. So it was, yeah, only through professional help that I was able to get through it because I didn't tell any of my friends or anyone what was going on. So yeah, that's probably what got me through it. And also, yeah, finding and connecting with other women on the internet was really what helped. So couldn't do it on my own.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I seriously applaud you for seeking help because like you said, a lot of women just want to go through this alone. And I think that's the worst mistake you can take, right? Is we do it because we isolate, you know, because again, we feel lonely. We feel like we're different. Nobody else is going through this. And reality is there's a lot of people going through it. And you shouldn't do it alone because of all these repercussions, right? Like this is real for everyone. Like Kim, I haven't met the first person that has said, oh, I had a joyful life when I started losing my hair.
Yeah.
I haven't met the first person. And if you're out there, please shoot me a note because I have not met the first person. So it is absolutely normal to go through these feelings of sadness and depression, a loss, and it's actually grief where you're experiencing, right? It's a loss of something.
Yeah, definitely. I sometimes refer to it when I speak to people that, it is like a grief process that you have to go through, which sounds really dark and traumatic, but that's how you kind of have to sort of look at it, because you're losing something that is a big part of you. They say in articles that I've read that losing your hair for a female or even a male is almost the same as losing a limb, that some people have classified that as. So it's, you know, it's a really traumatic experience. Mm-hmm. And it's really, really hard to go through it alone, which, you know, a lot of women do because they're embarrassed and, mm-hmm. you know, don't know what to say to people. So very, very difficult.
Yeah, very difficult. And so definitely reach out, you know, and seek help, because there is nothing wrong with that. And it's only going to be life-changing, and it's going to support you, because you get to be supported. That's what I tell everyone. It's like, you don't have to do this alone. And if you're doing it alone, it's almost by choice, because right now the community, the network, the resources that are out there, I so wish I had this 15 years ago. Like,
yeah,
please. They were non-existent. And imagine, I can't imagine the women before me, right? Like, I just right now, things are shifting. And so, and it's only going to get better, I truly believe. So just really rely on your community and the resources and everything that, you know, a lot of people didn't have. Like, feel like we're so blessed right now. So blessed.
Yeah, absolutely. Even 2 years ago, you know, when I started my account, there wasn't all of these other accounts on social media. So, you know, there's so many resources and so many other women sharing their journeys that, you know, now's almost the time that's like, it's a good time to kind of not be losing your hair, but there's so much information and resources out there that, you know, you can't kind of go wrong in that sense. Like, there's so many people that you can connect with and gather information from. So
totally. So on that note, tell us about your account. Like, what was your intention when you created it? And like, what has it, the journey been? Because I'm sure it's been crazy going from at zero to 12,000, I think you're at right now.
Yeah, so I was convinced by somebody that I met at like a hair loss meetup. I was 1 week into wearing like my first ever hair topper, and I went to my first ever meetup, and friend of mine now, she said, like, you should just start an Instagram. And I was like, I don't have time to do that. Like, I have a full-time job. And, you know, anyway, I digested that thought for about a week. And then I thought, you know what? I feel freaking fabulous, like, wearing my hair. And I want other women to know that, you know, there's options out there. So I decided that I would start my Instagram page, and I just thought, oh yeah, it'll be a few hundred people. You know, there can't be that many people out there. And then within the space of like a year, it got to, you know, I think it was almost 10,000. So it just exploded, and it made me realize how many women out there are going through this and dealing with these sorts of issues. And that's sort of what, made me want to stay on Instagram and continue sharing my journey and resources and information, because I thought it was so important to, you know, spread the word to other women globally, because I'm sure that there's millions of other women that haven't discovered my account or other accounts on Instagram yet. So that's why I have continued to do it. And, you know, I have a full-time job, and I do this outside of, you know, my personal life. So because it's something that's really, really important to me, and I'm really, really passionate about it.
Right. And I love that you're sharing that this is, you know, it's not everything for you, right? Because I feel like sometimes we have the misconception that what we see on IG is all that happens, and no, it's not. Like, women that are sharing their hairless journey, sometimes, you know, like you or like the big leaders, I want to call them, in the hairless community, have full lives, like you said, like full-time jobs, and sometimes full-time jobs and families, both, right? And then they get to serve you, us, right? So I just you know, I would love for you to hear your thoughts on that, because as I do more interviews and as I experience it myself slowly, I'm realizing that, you know, I love serving this community. Like, when I say I love it, I wake up in the morning excited about it. But at the same time, sometimes I experience that people think that they're the only person that has sent me that message. And I'm like, can I please get back to you in 2 days? Because this is going to take me a little bit of research. And like, now I get really good at saying that. Can I please get back to you in a couple of days? Because otherwise, like, I will be making false promises, and I don't want to, you know, have people waiting for me on things that I'm like, no, like, I really want to help you, but can you please give me a couple of days?
Yeah, definitely. I think it was a week or two ago I shared on my stories. It was a day in the life of Kim and some of the behind the scenes of what actually goes into, you know, posting on social media and what I sort of deal with. And the first thing that I did on my stories was, you know, I woke up at 6 o'clock and I posted on my stories and said, the first thing that I do is open my messages on Instagram, mm-hmm. and I'll respond to 20 or 30 different messages. That's the first thing I'll do. And then after that, it's, you know, trying to think of some kind of creative post to put up. And then after you've put a post up, you've got to respond to all of them. And this is all before like 9 o'clock when I start work. You know, it's not just like, oh yeah, I do it in an hour after work. Usually after work, I'm so drained from my job that I don't have the energy or the emotional capacity to be able to really dedicate to social media. And the thing that is really difficult sometimes is that, especially in the beginning, I felt like I had to respond to every single person, mm-hmm. and typically like I do, but like just us trying to set up an interview was a nightmare, because I don't have any free time. Like, I'm busy all weekends, and by the time I finish work, by 5 o'clock, I'm so done with everything. I just want to sit on the couch and just watch TV and, you know, eat some food, but I just don't have any kind of energy for social media. So I actually wake myself up earlier and try and dedicate it to doing Instagram. But then something always, you know, either gets in the way, and it'll be things like at the moment I'm trying to go to the gym and get healthy, and it's like, well, do I do that or do I dedicate more to social media? And then it's on the weekends, if I want to, you know, make a video or something, I've got to dedicate a whole day to that, because that kind of takes a lot of effort to not just make the video, because when I talk, if I'm not talking to somebody, I will stuff it up. And so it takes ages to do videos. And then there's the whole editing and uploading, and it takes ages to do all this stuff. So if I'm doing something like that on a weekend, I literally have to dedicate a whole day. So that's a whole day that I'm, you know, not meeting up with my friends or doing things that I want to do. So, you know, it does become a bit of a full-time side hustle sort of thing. And I'm not really getting a whole lot out of it either. Mm-hmm. Not that I want to, because I'm, you know, obviously passionate about this cause, but yeah, people don't see the behind the scenes of what actually goes on. And so when I have hundreds and hundreds of message requests, and sometimes I'll go and look at them, but I don't accept them because I just don't have the emotional capacity or time to respond to half of them. So it'll be, you know, once every couple of weeks, I'll go and look at some of the messages, and then it'll be, you know, somebody would have messaged me 2 weeks ago, and I just think, oh my God, I can't respond to them now because so much time has passed, and then feel all this guilt about not responding to these people because I know they're struggling. And yeah, so that's a little behind the scenes what goes on with social media.
Totally. And I love the word that you said, you know, responsibility, because you almost, like, once you have the platform and you're using a platform for a good cause, right, because it's a good cause, then you feel responsible to continue that labor, which is,
yeah,
for a lot of people, just a labor of love, right? Like, you're literally just contributing, right? Yeah. So I totally get that. And also, like you said, which what happens to me also is that I start thinking of where these people are with their hair loss. If, you know,
yeah,
if they're having, if they're in a really rough patch or they're like having a really bad day and like they're really struggling with it and they're looking for me, right, for solutions or answers or questions or whatever, I would love to be there for them, right? So like I want to answer to everybody, like you said. So it's almost like where do we find a balance of like contribute, but I also fill our own cup, right? Because we can't be so exhausted and yeah. and that we can't even contribute, right? Because we're going to be tired or whatever. You're not going to be the same contribution as in if you're actually dedicating the time, which happens to me a lot too. Cause I'm like, okay, so if I start this conversation right now, am I going to be able to have a conversation? Or am I just able to shed like one quick test back and then God knows when I'm going to be able to get back to him. So that's another thing that yeah, you're so right. Okay. Yeah. So speaking about your hair, like what's happening? So you started with a topper, right?
Yeah.
But right now is like, what do you wear? Tell us what you're wearing. What's your favorite? Did you already try both synthetic and human? Like tell us a little bit about that.
So this one is my first week, which I really love because it feels like what my hair used to be. Obviously more hair, but in terms of like the color and everything, it just feels like the old me, which is like kind of, I felt like I lost that person when my hair was falling out because I stopped coloring my hair. And it's, I've said that it's like a sense of familiarity. Like it's, yeah, I put it on and I was like, oh my God, I look like me. And it's not that I don't love like all my hair toppers and everything, because all of them I love for different reasons now. But this one was the one that felt most like me in terms of the color that I like to have on my head. Yeah. But it's hard to say like what's my favorite, because now I see wearing hair as like an accessory. So it depends on my mood or what I'm doing that day or what I'm wearing would depend on what sort of hair I'm wearing. Mm. So a lot of people say, what's your favorite brand? What's your favorite hair? This, that. And I'm like, well, I like all of the, anything that I post on my social media, I like all of them. And I have different reasons for why I like them. Some have a smaller base, so they're easier to wear, like, you know, if I'm just out casually and don't require a lot of effort. Some of them are a lot longer, so I feel a bit more glam and done up. Or there's like a wig, which is like, I'm still getting used to a wig, so it's hard to, you know, speak about the differences between that and a topper. But yeah, so I don't really have a favorite. They're just all, I feel like they're all me. Like it's hard to kind of say like, this is my identity now, because I don't really have like a, you know, a certain type of hair that I'll wear all the time. And I think people get caught up in trying to find the perfect piece that matches them, their hair perfectly, or, you know, has to be exactly right. And I say to them, you know, nothing's ever going to be exactly right. It's not growing out of your head. So you're never going to have anything that's 100% perfect. So you might as well just embrace, you know, the hair top or a wig that you've got. And just have fun with it. Like I literally use it as an accessory now. So yeah.
Right. And I also wanted to add that it takes time to get used to your pieces, right? Like sometimes like they look beautiful and they are beautiful, but it's going to take you some time to get used to it. And I think that shows, right? Like sometimes like we get it and the part is like right here and that's not really our part. So then we have to try and play with it and, you know, it also takes time to like manage and play your thing. And I want to say also that like how you feel about it is what's going to show, right? Because that's also, I see, you know, girls that have the same piece and they're like, oh, I'm wearing blah, blah, blah from blah, blah, blah. And it looks completely different than the next person, right? So that's also something to keep in mind is that we bring us into the picture. So, you know, just know that, right? Like all pieces are going to look different in different people.
Yeah. And that's the thing, like people worry that it doesn't look, you know, realistic or real, but then they'll see pictures of me or other people on social media with their pictures up and they're like, oh, it looks so real and amazing on you. And the thing that I always say to women who message me is it's about feeling confident in the hair. You know, I could pick out all of the things that are wrong with, you know, the hair that I'm wearing now or any of my other pieces, and I could go, oh, it doesn't look quite right, or, you know, it doesn't look realistic. But if you just wear it with confidence, people don't notice anything. Like, that's the reason people will say, oh my god, it looks so good on you. It's because I'm just being confident in it. Obviously it takes a little bit of skill and time and patience and learning how to deal with hair that isn't growing out of your head, but, you know, it all comes down to just feeling confident in yourself, in, you know, the hair that you're wearing, and that's what makes it look good. Because I'm telling you now, people don't notice that it's not your hair. And if they do, they're paying too much attention and they're getting way too close into your personal space, and they need to just learn social distancing.
Yeah, absolutely. Because especially right now,
I've had meetups with people, and I've literally, like, I'm so hyper aware of hair, right? And they've walked into the room, and I've organized a meetup with, you know, say 10 or so people. And some of them I haven't met before. So there's people that will come into the venue, and I'm looking for people that are wearing hair or look like they have hair loss. And there's people that will walk in and then will come up to the table because they obviously know me. And I will look at them and I'm like, are you wearing hair? Like, are you not wearing hair? I can't tell. And so if I can't tell and I'm looking for that at a hair loss meetup, nobody else is going to be able to know. I'm like telling you, nobody knows.
Wow. That is so true. Yeah. Because if we can't tell and we are the experts, imagine other people.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And it's so funny because we do walk around thinking that everybody's looking at our hair. Like, I remember, you know, the beginning when I started wearing hair, and they might, and that's the, here's another thing. It's like, they might be looking at your hair, but they might be thinking, wow, she has beautiful hair.
Yeah. That's the thing. Like, sometimes I think, oh, everybody's looking at me while I'm wearing this hair. And then I'm like, well, they probably are because I look amazing.
Exactly. Exactly.
Totally. Like, if that was me before I started wearing hair, I would be staring at those people too. Like, I'd be staring at those girls because their hair looks amazing. So,
yeah.
Yeah. Own it, ladies. Because it doesn't look realistic. It's, yeah, exactly.
Yeah. I love it. So, I know that from your posts and everything that you talk about, like, leaving us empowered with our hair is something that you're, you know, really passionate about. So for the ladies that I'm still like, I don't know if I should buy my piece, like, I don't know if that's for me, like, what would you say?
I would say, you know, it's really hard to tell somebody go and spend all this money on hair. But I know that it was something that was so life-changing for me. And I've had, like, hair extensions before, and in terms of the difference between hair toppers and wigs for people who have significant hair loss, like, hair toppers and wigs are so much better than extensions. Like,
oh my God,
telling you. but in terms of
damage your hair stuff, to begin with, for starters, they won't.
Yeah, exactly. But, in terms of telling somebody else what to do, I think, you know, you need to do your research and talk to lots of people, and don't just jump straight into something. Like, really look into what you're doing. You know, make sure that you've found, like, a hairdresser that can, you know, work on your piece, so that you can make customizations and all that sort of stuff. Because that's, like, for me, like, every single piece that I've had has been customized. And it's a big thing for people, I think, when they first get their piece, because sometimes it doesn't feel real. Sometimes the hair is too thick and falling on your face, and it's a lot to deal with when you've never, like, even tried one on before. So I think, yeah, finding a hairdresser, reaching out to people, like, find somebody in your area that you might be able to meet up with and ask them if you can try on their hair. Or, you know, go into a salon that sells hair pieces and just try some on. Like, don't just jump straight into something. Because I did that and I spent a lot of money, and I wish that I hadn't done that straight away. It was because I was impatient. It was because my birthday was coming up and my hair wasn't blonde, and I just wanted to deal with that situation. So I just spent all this money on a piece that was way too small and wasn't really the right thing. And, yeah, I wish that I had waited and done a bit more research. So yeah, I guess being patient and actually looking into it properly, that's probably the best thing if somebody is thinking about buying something, I would say.
Got it. Yeah, I think going to a local store, it's important, especially for measurements.
Yep.
And yeah, for me, I didn't do that. So I learned the hard way. That's why I'm saying that, because I didn't take my measurements, and like, you don't know if you're doing it right. So like, if you go to the right people, and also like, don't buy anything. I want to say, don't buy anything the first time you go to a shop. Like, there is no pressure.
Exactly.
You get to just go home and sleep on it and look at more things. Like, there is absolutely no rush when you're buying your first.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. Don't rush into anything is like probably the best advice. But everybody does. I did. Everybody does, because you're in this like mode of being desperate to want to just cover it up and fix it and have a solution. But if you can, you know, if you're worried about money and stuff like that, like, the best advice is just to research and be patient and don't buy the first thing that you see and don't rush into it.
Yeah. So Kim, last question, which I think is actually one of the most important questions I wanted to ask you, is how has this played out in your dating life?
Yeah. So when I first started my Instagram, which was a week after I got my first hair topper, I had just started dating somebody. So my experience with hair and dating has been like, it's been a bit of a journey. So I was already dating somebody who lived interstate at the time that I started wearing hair. We never really spoke about it, and it was never really that much of an issue. When that relationship ended, I was probably a week after I had met my now ex, and it was just never a thing that I had to really worry about, like dating and all that sort of stuff, because I'd only really experienced wearing hair with two people. Fast forward to this year, being single and going out on dates and meeting people and stuff, that's been a really interesting experience, because it was something that I've never had to sort of worry about before. And I've thought, you know, do I need to tell somebody straight up that I wear hair? Do I need to let them know? And I've had experiences where I have spoken about my hair on dates, and I've said, you know, extensions or whatever. I've had experiences where I've literally taken off my hair in the bathroom and, you know, that's just been it, and not even mentioned anything about it. I've had dates where I've actually gone into a lot of detail about my hair loss and wearing hair. Sometimes if I have met somebody and then we've spoken a little bit, if the topic kind of comes up about hair or, I don't know, something along those lines, usually what I do is I'll send them a picture of me wearing a purple wig, and that kind of prompts the conversation about, you know, wearing hair and stuff. And I just say to guys now, like, wearing hair for me is like an accessory. Like, you're going to see, I'll joke about it and say, oh, you're going to see blonde, like, this, my alter ego tomorrow, or like, you know, I might look different the next day or whatever it is. Like, I don't really ever talk about hair loss as such. I just mention, like, I just say, oh, I wear wigs and hair toppers, and, well, I don't say hair toppers, I wear hair extensions or hair pieces, and you know, I just kind of make it fun. I see it as the same as wearing makeup or, you know, clothes. Like, it's a way that I express myself rather than it being this sad story about me losing all my hair. So that's kind of how I approach it, because I think the way that you approach it with people, especially men or women, people in general, the way that you approach it is the way that they will also approach it. If you're feeling really sad about it, they're going to feel empathetic towards you and feel sorry for you. And that's something that I didn't want. I just wanted it to be this, you know, fun, not such a big deal, normal thing. And people never really have an issue with it when I tell them. They're just like, oh, cool. like, great.
Yeah. And I agree with you 100%. It's, you know, however you share it, that's how it's going to be received. If you're sharing it from a, you know, a victim perspective and, oh, this happened, it's so sad and da da da, first thing you're going to hear is, oh, I'm so sorry. And yeah, like you said, like for me, I didn't want anybody to feel sorry for me or think that I was sick, right? Because I don't consider myself as ill or sick person, yeah, right? I just happen to have a skin condition. So I totally get that. And then since I started sharing from an empowered place, that's how people receive it, right? And
yeah, absolutely.
Sometimes opens the door for them to connect with you, right?
Yeah, definitely.
Because they might even have something to share too, right? Like, you never know. So sometimes when you share, yeah, they're like, oh my gosh, like I also have blah. And, but it's just because they feel that connection. Like sometimes that's what I tell a lot of people is that when you start being open, you're giving the other people the opportunity to be open too, which is really,
yeah,
cool.
Absolutely. And I think there is a lot of strength in vulnerability as well. You know, I found that when I have shared my experiences with hair loss, not with just men, but with people in general, mm-hmm, I've had people say to me, oh yeah, like I had alopecia as a kid and I lost all of my hair. And I'm like, what? I never would have known that. Or they'll tell you an experience about something that they've had. And, mm-hmm, you know, it doesn't have to be like this big, horrible thing, because I found everybody has something going on. Everybody has something that they're more worried about with their insecurities than, you know, they are about you wearing hair or your hair loss. Like they are not worried about you or your hair loss. They're thinking about all the things that they're insecure about.
Exactly. Exactly. I love it. So Kim, with that, are there any last words of advice that you want to share with the audience?
I guess for me, you know, the thing that's helped me deal with hair loss and wearing hair is just to have fun with it. You know, it doesn't have to be this horrible, awful thing. For me, it's actually been one of the best things that's ever happened in my life. You know, mm-hmm, it opened opportunities to connect with women over social media, and I've made so many friends, not just in Australia, but globally, women that I talk to every single day. Mm-hmm. You know, it's allowed me to have fabulous looking hair. I don't have to color my hair. I don't have to worry about, you know, doing my hair now. And I just have fun with it and make it like a normal thing, just as normal as wearing makeup or, yeah, clothes, you know? So yeah, just try and normalize it. Like, it's not this big, awful, ugly thing. It's something that, you know, a lot of women are dealing with, and yeah, you're not alone in your experience.
Totally. Well, Kim, thank you so much. So, so much. And for everyone, yes, if you take like one thing out of this interview, let that be, you're not alone. You don't have to do it alone. There's so many of us out here. Please rely on your community. Yeah, we're here to help. And like, if you need anything, like, I'm sure Kim will be happy to help you guys hear all things mindset. Please reach out to me. And that's it. Well, thank you, everyone. I'll see you guys in the next interview.